God's grand scheme of things, that what we can learn from our pets and how that interconnected knowledge finds reassurance in the Gospel of Matthew, which encourages us to trust in the Creator's providence. Our scripture readings suggest that our four-legged and winged friends, even though we don't have any birds here today, are more than just emotional companions. Indeed, they can be God's way of pointing us to a more morally conscious position in the world. I'd like to begin this short reflection with an update on our little JV. Tammy, do you want to come up? There, Val. Stay close because I'm going to get back. All right. It was a little more than a year ago that Tammy came home from the bed, tears in her eyes and voice cracking, with the news that Jay had only a month or two at best to live. He had, and still has, an inoperable tumor in his left shoulder. And the vet said it would soon spread to his lungs, and death would come quickly. Many pills were prescribed, and we were told to make him as comfortable as possible. That was more than a year ago. And he's still here. It was devastating news then, to say the least. Tammy and Jay had formed a special loving bond. And I used to joke about how jealous I was because this little Shih Tzu, now 15 years old, had been my steady companion for more than a dozen years, especially during my seminary days when we would go for long walks around campus. Remember those? As I prepared a research paper or a sermon. But as Tammy and I waited with bated breath, not wanting to plan trips for fear we might miss his passing, Jay just kept limping and tail wagging forward. He seemed to sleep 20 out of 24 hours. But then he would bound across the parking lot like a puppy to greet me as I headed back to the parsonage. And the years would just roll away for both of us. I've learned a lot from Jay. I should say we have learned a lot from Jay. At the beginning, it was about love and loyalty and devotion. Even during those times, we all have them, and you don't feel so low. But in the past months, I've learned even more about living in the present moment, and how especially to drive away the fear of dying, which Stoic, though some of us like to pretend to be, is always there. Drive that fear away by embracing every belly rub and every scratch as if it were the first instead of possibly the last. So all of this thankfulness for this past year brings me back to the reality of what it means to live in what scriptures call the six-day world. But so many of us have a bloated opinion of ourselves and our place in God's creation, when so many seem to feel that the world was made for humanity alone, that plants and animals and other living things exist solely for our pleasure and sustenance. The first chapter of Genesis that I read reminds us that God intends for us to have dominion, as in do what we please, domination. Rather, as the original Hebrew replies, God intended for humans and animals who were all made on the sixth day, who share the same breath as we do of God's creation, to live together in a balanced shalom, that Hebrew word that refers to living in a shared harmony, is part of an interwoven tapestry where we each have our roles, two-legged or four-legged. The truth is that the Genesis story proclaims that we humans were originally blessed to be, in fact, co-creators with God of all that is and in all that is born anew each day. And as such, we're enjoined to be caring stewards of that ongoing circle of life. Anybody hear an Elton John song or I've seen it? It's in that context that we come together this morning to honor our relationships with our parents. Not because it's a cute or a touching thing to do, but because in blessing our animals, we are part of honoring our Creator and respecting the unique roles that we each have to play in God's kingdom. Yeah, talk about it. And my point is those who emphasize how glorious it is to be human neglect the pivotal teaching of Genesis, which is that all life is sacred and that we are to love all creatures. Those who point to humans as being at the top of the pyramid, elevated in the image of God, fail to understand that true dominion lies not in us, but in God. If we are rightly to understand how to exercise our dominion, we must strive to imitate and understand God's dominion. Careful examination of the Hebrew of that word reveals that it must be understood in terms of caregiving, nurturing, and not exploitation. As the image of God, we humans are called to relate to the non-human as God relates to us. And when we open ourselves to that caregiving relationship, we see that animals, especially our pets, have a lot to teach us. Albert Schweitzer once said, our pets bring us closer to that reverence for life. Whether it's to experience the serenity of a therapy dog's presence at the bedside of Memorial Hospital, as I've done, or running and leaping, or pet running and leaping into your lap after a period of absence, or the warm, throaty purr of a cat who is deemed to bless you with her presence. The sheer delight of a loyal pet's love and trust and acceptance is one of life's pure joys. Those who doubt whether animals have souls and feelings need only to turn to this morning's passage from Job that I believe also read. For the writer asks, who among all these does not know that the hand of God has done this? In whose hand is the soul of every living thing? All we need to know, Job suggests, is that God is ultimately responsible. But as Matthew implies in our gospel reading, as the writers of Genesis want us to understand, God has made us partners in his ongoing creation. That is, provided we bring in the same quality of trust and loyalty that our pets bring to us. Now, that's not to suggest that we're God's pets and playthings, for we humans are blessed, or maybe cursed, with the capacity to reason and to choose. But Matthew tells us that when we make our relationship with the Creator the main focus of our living, all those other things that cause us worry and stress, those false gods that so dominate our lives, those rigid positions we sometimes take and just can't seem to let go of, those will all be taken care of. Matthew's intent is to provide reassurance that in his ongoing grace and mercy, God will provide for us, just as we provide for our furry companions. My eye is on the sparrow, God says, and surely I'm not going to overlook you. So thank you this morning. Thank you for demonstrating your love of your animal companions, for sheltering and caring for them, to live with them and to care for them is indeed a privilege, a blessing, an exercise of humility and patience and respect for difference. This may be a service of blessing, but of course it is they who bless us. As the sign outside says, Wolfman, amen. Meow and shalom.